You're watching WCVB TV Boston. This is News Center 5 at 11.
One of Boston's greatest traditions, rocked by terror. The marathon under attack.
Just the bodies on the ground.
Tonight, a city on edge.
Smoke and debris everywhere. You know, across the finish line, screams.
An investigation unfolding.
There is no suspect.
And a nation in disbelief.
We will find out who did this. We'll find out why they did this.
You are looking live at Boylston Street tonight, blocked off by police at this hour, a scene of horror, and tonight the center of a sweeping investigation. Right now, the city is on alert. The nation is on the hunt for whomever set off the bombs, killing three people along the marathon route.
The images that we have been seeing tonight are just simply unforgettable, but they may also hold clues to who did this. That is the moment when everything changed. Just before 3 o'clock this afternoon, two separate explosions along Boylston Street as the runners streamed across the finish line.
At this hour, the death toll stands at three. One of them is an eight-year-old child. More than 130, in fact, the last number we had was more than 140 people were hurt. Several patients are in critical condition at this hour, and they're undergoing surgery at Boston hospitals.
The view from Sky 5 shortly after the blast shows just some of the damage. The city right now is on high alert. The area around Boylston Street still locked down. But the mayor's office says the city will be open for business tomorrow. So if you work in an area of the city not affected by today's explosions, you can come to work as scheduled tomorrow.
Police and federal agents are swarming all over the city. Police say that there are no suspects tonight, but several people are being questioned at this hour. We have team coverage for you tonight, every angle covered. And we begin with News Center 5, Sean Kelly. Sean.
Ed and Heather, as you mentioned earlier, Boylston Street is completely shut down. We're now moved about five blocks from the bomb site. When this happened, we were about a block and a half away. Our van shook when the first bomb went off. This was executed at a point for mass casualties, a point when runners were crowding Boylston and all of the sidewalks along Boylston were completely crowded as well.
The finish line scattered. Boylston opened for the stretchers and wheelchairs carrying the wounded to rush out.
When I made the turn, I mean, it was like the first pop, boom, and then another one, boom.
Get on the sidewalk.
Next to the blast sites, barriers collapsed into the final 100 yards of the marathon. Firefighters, volunteer medics, and runners tended to more than 100 victims.
Someone in the crowd yelled, like, don't panic, don't panic.
The man in this wheelchair had his legs blown off below the knees.
I need to know if he's okay.
Okay, we're gonna get you there right now.
Jerry Dubner was nearing the finish line on the opposite side of Boylston when the bombs went off.
Heard the first explosion and saw the smoke, but didn't really know what to think of it. I kept running and then all of a sudden there was the second explosion.
And what did you see?
Well, I first felt the shock from the explosion, then looked over in the direction of the explosion and saw some people lying on the ground, saw some blood there.
The area of Boylston Street that you're looking at right now, typically at the time of this bombing, when the race was going on, typically it would be nothing but people drinking water, getting the Mylar blankets on them, trying to cool down or warm up, whichever the case may be, meeting up with families. Time seems to have stood still at this point. No one out there now but police. Vehicles have been removed. The barriers in the middle have been removed along with the tables. This entire area is a crime scene. One thing to keep in mind, that after that first explosion, the first responders who were nearby, the volunteer medics, they were all running to a scene right before the second bomb blew up. So there was the possibility of a third or possibly fourth bombing, and these people were all running to treat people. Live on Boylston Street, Sean Kelly, WCVB News Center 5.
And we have been talking about some of the very seriously injured. 29 of those patients went to Mass General. Many of the other hospitals around the area are treating quite a few patients as well. Let's get you over to MGH right now. Liam Martin is there live. Liam?
Heather, as you said, 29 of those 140 patients have been here at Mass General. 8 of them are critical, and one of the lead surgeons here stressed that those are truly critical. Some of those are touch-and-go situations, very traumatic injuries. Because the blast was from down low, a lot of these are lower extremity injuries. People, as Sean pointed out, losing their limbs, and a lot of those have been coming here into this hospital. We've seen a number of amputations, according to the doctors here. But there was also shrapnel that was a concern after that blast. A lot of the patients here being treated for small bits of metal debris that they were struck with during the explosion, and of course that can lead to further complications. One of the lead trauma surgeons here at MGH described that for us.
A lot of shrapnel injuries. Many of those involve, again, predominantly the lower extremities, but shrapnel injuries can affect the entire body. A number of patients will require repeat operations tomorrow and serial operations over the next couple of days. So as I mentioned, a lot of the injuries are combined. They're combined bony and soft tissue and vascular injuries, and they have to be approached oftentimes in kind of a stepwise fashion. Yeah, I mean, it's just depressing that, you know, we take care of accidents all the time. It's just depressing that it's intentional.
Have you ever seen it?
As Dr. Fagenholt said, you know, they deal with injuries, severe injuries, of course, here at this hospital all the time. But, of course, the magnitude of this one is far beyond that, just in terms of the fact that this was, as he said, on purpose. A couple of other updates here. There have been, as I said, several amputations that have had to be performed here, in addition to the limbs that were lost simply from the explosion themselves. We do have at least one shattered eardrum to a patient here at Mass General Hospital. I'm sure that is true at some of the other hospitals as well, because that blast, as it's been described by a number of eyewitnesses to us, was so loud that it actually shattered the eardrum of one of the patients here. You can see they still have some security set up here at Mass General, and that's been one of the stories throughout the course of the day here, is that there's been heightened security as they try to make sure, of course, that there's no other issues here. In fact, for a time, they had this entire area locked down because they believed that there was some sort of a suspicious device up in the parking garage. That was cleared and found to be nothing. But as the doctor was saying, a lot of the patients here, again, 29 of them, 8 of them critical, have a long road ahead. A lot of these are going to require serial surgeries, as he called them, over the next several days. And we do know, again, that 8 of them are critical, and some of those touch and go.
That's Liam Martin, who's reporting live from us for Mass General. The core of the crime scene is in Copley Square, and that's where Jorge Quiroga has been all night. Jorge?
Well, one of those big changes at this hour of night, a lot of the police cars that had been swarming the area, rushing around all evening, some of that activity seems to have died down. Earlier today, we were told that there had been a lot of calls to police with people concerned about suspicious packages. Those were being checked out. Behind us, you can see the area, which is now a crime scene and probably the center of the investigation, where all the different law enforcement agencies are gathering. That's where the medical tent was and is now turned into the headquarters, as it were, of the investigation. Right next to me, you can also see that as marathoners have left, the international media and the national media moved in. These folks from Fuji Television in Japan. There's also folks here from German television. I've also spoken to folks from Latin American television, a reporter from Colombia. Obviously, this has become a national, international event. Now, I also did get a chance earlier this evening to talk to folks who had the vantage point of being right there, right in front of the blast scene, right by the finish line. Let's hear what they have to say.
Suddenly, this big explosion took place in front of me, and then I saw this big cloud with smoke, and my first instinct was to just run across the street and start helping out the people.
Your sleeve there, is that blood on the sleeve?
And my pants, my clothes, and...
Show me that flag.
The flag, well, that was a flag I was holding the whole time, and this is how the flag ended up carrying the blood, all these victims.
You turn around and just see smoke rising, smoke and debris everywhere, you know, across the finish line, screams, people running, and it doesn't make sense to me.
My niece thought it was a cannon, and then a couple seconds later, we saw it on the next block, and then we were just paralyzed. We didn't know to go left, right, back.
What'd you do?
The cop kept telling us, you gotta get out, you gotta get out, you gotta clear out.
Now, the first gentleman you heard from, Carlos Arredondo, he is the father of a war veteran who was killed in Iraq in 2002. He was at the finish line, he said, to welcome National Guard, members of the National Guard who had run the marathon. He said the first thing he did, he ran to them, and as you could see, all his clothing and that American flag covered in blood, a very, very sad scene. I've also spoken to other marathoners, folks who either finished the race or who did not finish the race. Of course, they're very concerned, very upset. I asked them if they would, if this is in any way changes their habits, what they would do. Will they come back next year? 201, they said everyone will be returning for the 118th. Whoever did this is not going to keep them away. Although one woman did say it might change the way she gets her friends to come. She may not have them waiting at the finish line for her. As of now, again, the area is starting to get some activity. A lot of taxis bringing people around. It is a very sad night here in Copley Square. Jorge Quiroga, WCVB News Center 5.
It is effectively a big crime scene, and we have a map of the crime scene area. We've outlined it in yellow. Jorge was right in the heart of that. Jorge was on Dartmouth Street, right? You see the words Copley Square? That's where Jorge was. This is effectively from Clarendon Street at the top of the picture all the way down to Hereford Street. Boylston Street is in the core of it. The yellow street that extends the north boundary is Newbury Street. So if you work in that area, you expect to go to work tomorrow, just be mindful, be very patient as you go through there, because it's going to be difficult. That area remains an active crime scene right now.
It is being swarmed with federal authorities right now, and Kathy Curran is here. This investigation is already advancing, isn't it?
It is, Heather, and it's a very active investigation. The FBI is the lead agency on this investigation. This, as I said, is a very active criminal investigation. It's being called a potential act of terrorism. And sources tell me as we speak, there is a federal search warrant being executed in Revere. We know there were two devices that exploded on Boylston Street. Sources tell us these were very sophisticated and very powerful bombs that exploded. There was a third and incendiary device at the JFK library, but that may not be related to the blast
the sidewalk,
close to the finish line.
The
investigators
the
are going through surveillance
the
video
sidewalk.
In the area. They're looking for any pictures or videos for clues. There is a heightened presence of law enforcement in the city when we were in there earlier. We're talking federal investigators, including the FBI, Homeland Security, ATF, the Joint Terrorism Task Force, Secret Service, state and local police from several different departments, and the National Guard has been deployed throughout the city. There will be random searches of backpacks and bags in the city. Sources tell me a man in a Boston hospital is being questioned in relation to the explosions, but at this point, no arrests, no suspects have been officially named. We've also learned an off-duty U.S. Immigration and Customs officer who was a spectator sustained non-life-threatening injuries during the explosion. So again, this is just a very active, ongoing, developing situation, and as we get more information, we'll bring it to you.
Key points. So no one's in custody.
No one's in custody right now. We're told this person who is being questioned is cooperating with the investigation. But at this point, no suspects have been named and no arrests.
And to be clear on that, too, that person is not even being identified as a suspect. Or a victim or whatever. Is it someone who's
not at this point.
Not at this point.
As the president said, don't rush to judgment in this case. Let the authorities do their jobs and do it well.
Exactly. You know, there is a lot of work being done out there, and this is developing very quickly. So we have to be very careful.
And as of it's 11:13 at night, there's still no known connection between what happened at the JFK library and what happened in downtown Boston today.
They're not exactly sure at this point. They're not sure if it was related.
News Center 5's Kathy Curran, Team 5's Kathy Curran reporting for us the latest.
Thanks,
what her sources
Kathy.
Have been gathering for us today. Is again, this is a situation that they're going to move very carefully, very gingerly, and very delicately through as they put the pieces together to find out what happened.
It's now been about 8.5 hours, and we want to take you back out to News Center 5's Kimberly Bookman now. She has the latest on what's happening downtown. Kimberly?
Well, Heather, you know, we've heard so many stories of people who were spectators right at the finish line who saw everything happen. And one of the ones that was just most jarring, the one that was most stunning to us, was the story of Tony Clinton. Go ahead and take a look at this home video. He actually shot this video after the second explosion. He says he didn't know what hit him after the first one, and then he looked to the side and heard another one within 10 seconds, and then he started running alongside so many others who didn't know where to run to. He said there was no direction. People were wondering, are we going in the right place? place? Should we go any further? Is anything else going to happen to us? And it was this state of panic and concern. He says at one point he had to turn to his friend. He really thought that was the end for him. Take a listen.
We are like, boom. We turn this way, we only can see a smoke, and we look like nearby, we see bleeding, we see blood and everything. At that time, we try to run to other direction, and then the second explosion happened the other direction. We feel like we are trapped. At that moment, it was me and my friend, we just tried to hug each other, and we feel like this is it. We're not going anywhere.
So you can tell just how emotional. You can tell just how emotional Tony was listening to that sound. Obviously, you know, we've talked about all of the people who have physical scars, and certainly that is so traumatic. But for so many people who witnessed these terrible, horrific, horrific attacks, there are so many scars that they too are dealing with nightmares tonight. Reporting live from Clarendon Street, Kimberly Bookman, WCVB News Center 5.
And just to watch the video that Tony took, this is you can see that the people in restaurants are out, workers inside restaurants are out, a number of people just stuffing the alleys. Just you don't know where to go because you have one explosion at one point along the race line at Boylston Street, another explosion two blocks behind you. What direction do you go in? Is there going to be the next explosion? I mean, it's that kind of confusion that led Tony to feel like many did. Is this it? Is this the end?
And from all accounts, this was a deafening blast. I mean, from everyone we have heard describe what they felt, how it reverberated through them, this was different. You know, you hear a cannon go off when there's a fireworks celebration, and it sort of spooks you and you jump. But this had something else to it that told people, what was that? It was something that was just crazy different. And as soon as that second blast came, which was 10 to 13 seconds after the first, people knew that they had to get out of there. Interesting, though, you see people who, the instinctual reaction to something like that is flight, to run away from it. And then you see these ultimately heroic people who run toward it.
I'm
always astonished by that.
Here's what the president said in reference not only to what happened here in town, but it happening on Patriots Day. Here's Mr. Obama.
Today's a holiday in Massachusetts, Patriots Day. It's a day that celebrates the free and fiercely independent spirit that this great American city of Boston has reflected from the earliest days of our nation. And it's a day that draws the world to Boston's streets in a spirit of friendly competition. Boston is a tough and resilient town, so are its people. I'm supremely confident that Bostonians will pull together, take care of each other, and move forward as one proud city. And as they do, the American people will be with them every single step of the way.
The president's reaction this evening to the incident in Boston, where now three are dead, 140 plus injured in the Boston Marathon explosions this afternoon.
And as we have heard throughout the evening, if you're just joining us for the 11 o'clock news, many of these injuries are deep tissue injuries with muscle involvement and bone involvement. And these patients who have undergone surgeries today will be undergoing, as Liam said, serial operations. That means they're going to be in and out of surgery just about every single day for the next week as they try to repair and get them ultimately to mend. But some of the injuries were so incredibly critical and so complex, so many of them between tissue and bone and muscle, that they can't do it all at once. They have to take it operation by operation.
This is the moment of the explosion, and we have explosions, and we have shown you this before. So let's show it again, and I want you to watch the marathon runner. Watch the guy in the orange in the middle of the screen. How he goes down, right? There's the first explosion. Wait for about five more seconds. The second explosion. That's the second explosion. ESPN tonight talked with that marathon runner who went down. Here's what he said. Listen.
Tell me about what happened when you came around the finish line.
Well, I was heading for the finish line. I was feeling pretty good about my time, and everything looked real good. I got within about 15 feet of the finish marker, and a terrible explosion. It was so loud, it just deafened everything. And the shockwaves must have hit my body, and my legs just started going like noodles, and I knew I was going down right there. So I lit on the blacktop, and I wasn't unconscious at any time, but I woke up, become alert a little later, and looked everything over, and it looked okay. So I made an attempt to get up, and as I did that, one of the assistants at the finish line had seen what I was doing and come over and give me a hand. And so he walked me on over to the finish line so I could finish. And then he said he'd maybe take me over and give me a wheelchair ride out of there. But at that time, I said, I don't think I need it. Hotel's about 6 blocks away, so I can get up there.
Bill, when you first heard the explosion, what did you think it was?
It sounded like a bomb. Yeah, it was just so loud. Oh, just deafening. My ears are still not the same right now.
And when you looked around, what was the reaction? What do you remember seeing as you're falling down?
Well, I seen a bunch of dust and looked like a pot or something like that laying about 5 feet away from me. That must have been part of the bomb that went off. And, well, that's it, you know. But I still didn't have any clue about what was going on.
What's it been like, the camaraderie with the other runners that you've spoken to that might have gone through what you went through?
Really haven't had a chance to talk to too many of them since that happened. But I'm sure they feel about the same way I do about it. They hope that we don't ruin something that we all love to do by this sort of thing.
This is your third Boston Marathon.
Yeah.
In your wildest imagination, could you ever imagine something like this happening?
No. Well, I came last year, and the weather was so bad last year. It was so hot, I had a really bad day. But this year, I had a good day. I had a good time, but this incident did kind of spoil it.
Life-changing for a lot of people. How will this affect you going forward?
Yes, I don't think it'll affect me too much, but I'm going to keep in mind. I hate to see it.
Will you run the Boston Marathon again?
I don't know about that. It's going to take a while to forget this one.
Back home to Washington State?
Yeah, let's clear Washington State. That's quite a job getting back here, so we'll see.
Well, we're glad you're safe. Thanks for talking to us.
Yeah, you bet.
Bill Ifrig, who ran the Boston Marathon today and did cross the finish line.
He did, and he is, again, the guy right in the middle of the screen. The guy who goes down right at the explosion, right? That's Bill.
Oh, I'm so happy to hear from him tonight.
And he said the shock waves knocked him down. And then we have somewhere in our vast array of collection of pictures of what happened today, the attendant who actually attended to him and helped him get up and get across the finish line.
Bill, I hope if you're listening right now, I know he's heading back to Washington State within the next day or so. Bill, go get that hearing checked out. I know a lot of folks are going to be suffering from hearing problems, and a lot of people have damage to their ears that they don't realize they have. And I hope if he didn't get checked out today, that's the picture.
There's the picture I was talking about. That's Bill on the ground, and look at this.
See, an example of someone who runs toward danger.
Runs toward danger.
I'd love to see that.
Helps him get reoriented, get back. Are you okay? Yeah, fine. And then they get up and they go across the finish line.
So, all day when I saw that video over and over again, I was hoping for a moment like this. Bill, I'm so glad you're well.
The hero, the guy in the yellow jacket. You know, you're a hero in my book, my friend. You're a hero in my book. Let's get on to Brigham's, and that's where Kelly Tuttle is tonight. Kel?
Well, Ed, if you take a look, things have quieted down just a little bit here at the Brigham. Still at the front door, you're going to see heavily armed officers, as you see just behind us here. But in general, the scene has quieted down. Far fewer officers than what we were seeing earlier. If we show you some of the tape from a bit ago, you know, we were watching people like from the ATF and the FBI all swarming into the Brigham not a long time ago. It's a very kind of confusing picture at this, because it's widely reported that there is someone of interest here at the hospital, but then the Boston Police Commissioner adamantly saying there's no suspect and that there wasn't anyone they were talking to at the hospital. We do know, of course, that police were here and talking to witnesses, runners, other patients, and trying to glean from them as much information as possible. The numbers continuously go up in terms of the patient load here. At last check, 31 patients, and here's the head of the emergency room department to update us on their conditions.
So these are blast type injuries. These are very high force, high impact injuries. So they cause a lot of damage to tissue and to bone. So we see injuries where people have extensive muscle injury, broken bones, often what we call open fractures, fractures where the bone is broken and the tissue has been opened above that. So a lot of lower extremity and sort of high impact blast injuries, and then down over the spectrum to some people had relatively minor injuries and things like having their eardrums affected by the amount of the blast.
And tonight, 9 surgeries in all planned here at the Brigham. As you look live at the front entrance, I can tell you as each patient was brought in, they did testing to see if there were contaminants on them, like radiation. All the patients brought in tested negative for those types of contaminants. And the final thing we can tell you, you heard a lot earlier about ball bearings and extra things possibly being in this bomb explosive device. What they're saying at the Brigham is they found no evidence like that. They found things like metal, shrapnel, things that would have come from material around the bomb site, but nothing that looked like it had been added to the bomb that they found, at least in the patients here at the Brigham. Reporting live, I'm Kelly Tuttle, WCVB News Center 5.
And Kelly, just to clarify, when we're talking about them not finding any evidence of radiation, that is significant because immediately when you hear of an explosion in this post 9/11 world, people worry about dirty bombs. That really ruled that out.
Yeah, so standard, I mean, I asked, and you heard it earlier, we'll explain what it works, because, you know, we're at the airport, we see swabbing, that sort of thing. I didn't know how it worked, but it's a machine that they can test around the patients who came in, and I believe MGH, same thing, so I assume all the hospitals, standard protocol is you don't want to be bringing this into the ER and possibly affecting everybody here, so you need to know that the patients are safe, so you test them before they come in, so you can make sure you can treat them safely.
At least that was something good that came out of this, Kelly. Thank you very much. Kelly Tuttle reporting live from the Brigham. We do want to say, as we've talked about a number of things, and the BSO canceling some performances.
And the Celtics game tomorrow was canceled.
And now we've just learned that Emerson College, Emerson, is closed tomorrow for what the school is calling healing and reflection. So there will be no campus classes at Emerson College tomorrow.
The Bruins game tonight was postponed. That will be made up. The Celtics game for tomorrow has been canceled. That will not be made up. It won't be made up because there's no reason in the standings that it need be made up. The game is not important, so they will not play the game. We have some pictures of the minutes after the explosion itself, and this is Boylston Street. This is right in front. Pictures from Wicked Local that are quite telling. And if you just look at the images in the pictures, the fear on the woman's face, the cut on the man that's on the ground, the blood on the sidewalk that's there scattered, it's just horrifying in the moments after the explosion itself. Take a look at the next one. The next one has an officer with, first this is a guy running through and you can see the smoke, but look in the background. That's the second explosion that had just gone off, just as this guy, runner 19797, is moving forward to the finish line trying to process what would be the unprocessable. And look at the authorities in the picture. They're all reaching for their sidearms and they're moving toward a spot, trying to react to what's going on. And at the same hand, they're preparing to respond in any way that they might have to respond to what's going on. These pictures are very telling. In the moment after the explosion, this officer clearly hand on gun, focused as people are running away, focused on what's going on the side. And the grandstands are being evacuated. Those are the grandstands that are right in front of the library.
Local authorities had, you know, obviously for their years of experience in dealing with a marathon, were out in full force. And they had great coverage there and were able to help people right away. But you got to imagine what's going through their heads when you see every single one of them, you're right, reaching for the sidearm there.
And this runner, you know, 19-4-18, he has, it would appear to be a headset of something around there. So maybe he's listening to music, maybe he's listening to something. And then the explosion happens and he reacts to it. He says, my goodness, what's going on here? And the look at the woman in the lower left-hand corner, sunglasses on, hands over the ears. This is what you were talking about, the sound of the loud explosion tearing through the ears, and she just can't handle it. This is the explosion. Now, these are still pictures of that explosive moment. Here's the video of that explosive moment. And then 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 seconds later, the second explosion.
And you can hear the absolute panic in the crowd as they realize that the first one was not some sort of fluke thing, that this was really some kind of attack.
Boston Police Commissioner Ed Davis was at the latest briefing. Here's what he said about an hour or so ago.
No, there is no specific type of truck that we're looking for at this point in time. We are looking for any information that people have as to what they saw or might have heard at the site of the explosion or coming and going. We're investigating all leads right now.
What's the latest death and injury toll?
We don't have the number of casualties at this point in time. This is very early in this investigation. We wanted to get out here and give you as much information as we had, but we cannot tell you exactly how many people have been injured.